happens every month where I get like really, really sad that this is almost over as we introduce our very last reader. She's come to Ice Cream Social before and I had the opportunity to meet her, and she introduced me to so many other writers that we can add to the series, and we're very grateful for her. So first things first, we've got her zine on this back table.
$2.
It's like a steal. And it's dedicated to tonight, to us. So she can't sell them anywhere else. You guys have to come through. No, but they're beautiful. And if you RSVP'd on Facebook, it told you to bring your monies, so you rewind. But again, we're so grateful and we're honored to introduce our final reader for tonight. Marilyse V. Figueroa is a queer Chicana Puerto Ricana who grew up hearing fairy tales, myths, and her mother's cuentos from El Campo. These inherited stories are the places she visits to write about the magic, light and dark of esta vida. Marilyse is currently working on her MFA in creative writing in Central Texas and is a community activist and educator in the fast-growing youth writing workshop, Barrio Writers, as the director of the San Marcos Tejas chapter. She has works published in Letterialidad, I can write it up, you guys, The Essentials Review, Santa Sucia Zine, Chiflada Zine, Gemini Inc., AAX blog, I write that for you guys then too, and her debut short story collection, Benevolent Altar, is forthcoming from Broken River Books. Her staple flavor of ice cream was cookies and cream until the combination of caramel, sea salt, and chocolate revolutionized the world.
Hello, this is awesome to see everyone. There's so many faces that I love to see all the time, and so many faces that I don't get to see enough, and then of course the new friends I've made too. So I wanted to read something I usually don't read, which are love poems, but since someone I love very much is here, I thought I would read these. So let's just get started with that. And then this makes me feel like I'm a stuffy professor. So, cool. All right, this is just a poem I don't have a title for in three parts. Grab a hold, take hold, but don't bother me with question. Red veins and blue lines, grab a hold and take comfort. But don't bother me with scripts I can't read. I, illiterate monkey heart, I eat moss with every kiss. Grab a hold, take a breast, a dewdrop, not a puddle. Splash inside my insular world. You'll not drown while I'm here. Here's two. Swollen bodies, mammalian organs, tendrils covering my eyes, an orange peel when I close them, a scene of rich fields when I open them. Bodies rough and tired, and only soft after kneading, a taste of sulfur at the fingertips, a glass of silver when I engulf him. Tenticular lips on the ribbons, satin and silk, wet after so many rainfalls. Doesn't tidy in the morning, a venison pupil, horizontally fixed in the knot of her, an orange peel when I open them, a scene of rich fields when I close them. Here's three. Orchid, flash your sucker on my finger pads, on the markings of my swirling signature, your green tongue extended delicately. My ribbons never keep the knot for long. Pick you up off the rainforest floor, take you from your vine. Orchid, wrap yourself around this finger here, and I'll point us south to Yucatan. I'll point us east to España, I'll sprawl across El Golfo, where your scent will carry and untie and unlock the markers of my signature, This small monkey's heart wants to say, orchid, I am the tree.
So there's that.
So a reason why it's so great to be in this community and at Ice Cream Social, which is a lot about community, is that that's something I think we all need, especially as writers and artists. And one of my, or a lot of actually my community members who support me as a Latina artist are here, and it's very empowering. However, I think it's still important to, you know, have your own experience and you have your own struggles and fights to speak with your voice. Something that I've learned from the founder of Barrio Writers and the Barrio Writer Writing Advisors is that our voice is our weapon. So this piece was published in the Accentless Review called, I think it was called Latinx, Our MFA Experiences. So here's a kind of, to open up that whole piece, you can find it online. Here's a quote from Matthew Salasis, who's a Korean-American writer. He's in Houston. He says, "So many of the advantages workshop offers break down when a writer is in the workshop minority, especially when this minority status matches the status in the outside world, and most especially when this fact goes unacknowledged, that the typical workshop actively disempowers the singular voice." So this is called, "My MFA Doesn't Have a Writer of Color on Faculty." And that's also how it starts. "My MFA doesn't have a writer of color on the faculty, but my mama says that doesn't matter. One, my MFA has said my stories make you work for them. Mira, estas coiled images y rattling syntax. Mis cuentos must be scary cosas to critique. I write Spanglish con at signs and equis, a nueva hybrid of oral and written. Claro, my stories are laborious, heavy criaturas. Like the story about my resistance to assimilation, or the one where I work through the racial trauma of losing my mother tongue. Everyone liked the story about the queer women, but didn't want to comment on their brown skin. These stories, my MFA says, are not for everyone. Two, situation. You're an artist. You create from life. Life is spoken in English, Spanish, and Spanglish. You cannot stop thinking in stories. You see the paletero's life story as he rings his bell on Flores Street. You still ask your mama to tell her stories from El Campo, from her college days, from raising you and your wild sister. You don't want to forget. Three, situación. You're an artist. You create from la vida. Life is being Chicana, a poly identity. You write to make sense of this and heal others, hopefully. You cannot stop thinking in stories. Meanwhile, the master story gives praise to the white artist. You still ask yourself, why are these artists rallying against diversity like you're trying to take away their favorite toy? You ask your mama, why does history repeat itself? You don't want to forget. My MFA says that they can't wait until I write stories for non-Latinos. And my mama says, mija, you keep writing. So my next story was published in Literaridad, which is an online journal, and I was really excited for it to get published because I think as writers who are maybe in their MFA or just out in the world trying to get somewhere, trying to make a living out of this writing life, you know, we sometimes focus on the business side, and I think that takes away from our art. So I was excited that Literaridad accepted my piece. It's going to be part of my short story collection coming up next spring, because it's a story in Spanglish, and Literaridad is from Colombia, and there's like their first issue that they were doing in bilingual, with bilingual literature. And also, I mean, I have no idea if they know about this in Colombia, but San Antonio is a great place. As Austin. But when I moved to Texas, my mom's from Texas, but we didn't live here. But when I moved here, I moved to San Antonio, and as I would say, an olive tan woman in the Southwest, I'm brown, in the Midwest, I'm brown, which is weird. So moving to San Antonio and actually being around like a very vibrant Latin community was just like a revolution for me. So this story, Volar, which I'm about to read, has pictures from my first few months in San Antonio, where I was just really taking in the beauty of the place. There's, I mean, I've never lived in a place with ruins, right? The Midwest is such a new place. There's no ruins. So that was amazing to me. There's like so many stray dogs in San Antonio, which is sad and weird, and I want to befriend all of them and make a farm. And like if you can kind of, if you take out a magnifying glass, which you all have, this is kind of like a roadmap of what happens to my character, where she goes in the story. So even if you don't buy one, I would love if you take a look if you're interested. Okay, and I'm gonna open this story with a quote. Pies, para que los quiero, si tengo alas para volar. That's by Frida Kahlo. Here it goes. A red bandana, a holy smile. The brown skin I adored and pitied met my light skin I loathed and pitied. You took the $5, five because La Iglesia was getting a big tip. You, brown street corner angel, retired cholo lowrider, you kissed my hand as if I was a Spanish señorita and you a gentleman. The next Sunday, lo mismo corno, lo mismo brown angel, but did I mention, I kind of wondered at your dancing. No cardboard sign for you, no wave unless it's a wave of your arms praising the cars go by. Are you dancing? No, you're beating your arms up and down like a brown street corner angel. And the 84-year-old woman I was told called Mamo, not my real abuela, says, Irena, no, not him. Takes my $5 with her arthritic hand and stuffs it in her bra. I don't offer to take her to church after that, because I'll spend my minimum wage any way I want. She can stay in that damn house on Theo. Is it true that you were there when they stabbed Mamo's cousin, outside of St. James Church, where everyone should have been safe? He was a pachuco, Mamo, la mala abuela, la abuela de chismes, says, with a yellow newspaper clipping in her hand. 84-year-old self-hating Mexican who saves the obituaries of her friends in a cookie jar, pulling them out when her sons come to visit to excavate memories and push them on to blood. As one of her son's stepdaughters, I get the stories too. You look like him, my cousin, she says. But I'm not blood, I tell her. See, I can't move out, and I wish I hadn't moved in. So this was the agreement when I moved to San Antonio. Mamo is old, and she needs someone to look after her. But I'm not sure who is doing who the favor. Mamo's cousins live right around the corner. But see, no one visits or calls her, and Mamo complains to her blood, and now me too. But I wouldn't visit her either after what she said, chismosa. But then I see Mamo sitting at the table, sorting her coupons. Then I see Mamo alone in her bedroom with her back brace on, saying she's gonna give up cable. Then I see Mamo stroke the black and white photo of her son who's still lost to Vietnam. And damn it, I go to hug her. La mala abuela. I drive until I find you running across the busy streets, like you know where every car will be, like you care, then you don't care. I call you over, see your smile. I look in. You take me into your storied mouth, each missing molar, a novel each. Are you blood? I listen to Father David make sense of the world's injustices every Sunday. The floods, the shootings, the hatred, the reasons I can't get away. He says, put su fe in the water and wine, in the prayer altars and offerings. And there's a moment where I always cry in the quiet without the cicadas and Mamo's TV. One Sunday, you're not on your corner. I circle until I've missed the homily. You can't take the communion without the lesson. One day, Mamo pushes her walker to the window, tells me to see what's going on. I'm putting my hair up into a bun for work. I'm no good at smiling for customers anymore, not like how I smile for you. All I hear is cicadas and realize a sound's missing in Theo's cacophony. It's the neighbor's dogs. Got out of their yard, blood in the street again. Real ugly, she says. Then you, brown street corner angel, stop dancing. You help the neighbor's 11-year-old boy get the dogs out of the road. You don't let him cry. 84-year-old anti-Semite who makes me pork chops and corn on the cob every night. Did you eat? She always asks me as I come in. If I say yes, ella está enojada. I cooked, she'll say. Unlike my mother who would slam pots and cupboards, she still welcomes me to the table to talk. But I know why. She wants to tell me, because I'm somebody, anybody, that she hasn't had alcohol all day, that the cars wailed as they scraped their axles on a pothole in front of the house, and the neighbor's new puppy only barks and hides in a cardboard box when he sees her. The dog is I always want to say caramel or caramel. You decide. The dog is caramel like my skin, she says. I wish I had your skin, like vanilla. I remember learning vanilla came from Mexico, was taken from Mexico. Does she? I leave at 9 p.m. and Mama worries. Too late for a girl, for a woman to be out. I try to believe I'm above rolling my eyes at that. And she's embarrassed for me as I'm driving myself. Mama didn't know how to drive until her husband died. Sometimes she talks about the dances she would go to. She says her friends were always jealous of her because she never danced alone. Her son says she used to come home home after the bailes with a cup still in her hand. She said they were confused. It was her son Leroy, but he wasn't even old enough to make stupid choices before he left. Is it wrong to get a thrill out of hiding something from Mamo? Is it wrong because it's about you? I drive and I find you sleeping under a live oak in Mission Park. I put a paper plate down on the grass and leave. Pork chop and corn on the cob. I hope you have enough teeth for the meat. When grackles fly from river reeds, I pray for you, but it turns into a prayer for me. Your beating wings could take me high above the missions, past Father David, above La Taqueria Michoacan, and far. Please take me far from the iron bars on Theo. Mama returns from shopping with viejitas and calls her sons, voicemails. Calls again and hangs up. Why don't they call me, mis hijos? Why? When I dream in Mama's house, I see into the soil. I see the worms and the maggots and the lost tin toys of her hijos. I see a woman buried in a shoebox, roots pushing out of the top. Dear Lord, make us agaves outside of the old steel factory on Flores Street. Let us sit like sentinels as our spikes grow to 50 feet. You, Brown Street corner angel, retired pachuco, zoot suitor, addict, lover, father, brother, you don't let me cry. You and I fly far from this corner on Theo, with our teeth buried deep under cement and riverbed, brown and yellow and white, just teeth from anyone. Just teeth. Thank you.
My heart's really full. This is like every month it just fills us up with enough strength to get through to the next month. So we're really grateful for each and every one of you. Our next one is going to be the Galentine's edition on February 24th. So you know on February 15th I'm walking to Target. Buying everything. Please, if you have, like, approach us. We're really shy and weird, so we're not going to approach you. But yeah, everybody is, this is an amazing community. Please get to know each other. Please browse books. Tell all of your friends.
We're going to bust out the ice cream. If you did your postcards, I would love to send a stack. To you know, whoever you want to send them to. So if you did the postcard, please hand them to me before you leave. I would love to just flood some mailboxes right now.
Or you can leave them at the counter. Yeah.